VCY America presents Crosstalk, a nationwide call-in program discussing issues that have an effect on our families, our communities, our churches, our nation, and our world. Crosstalk, an opportunity for you to voice your concerns for biblical principles. And now live by satellite and around the world on the internet at vcyamerica.org. Here is today's Crosstalk.
Well, welcome to Crosstalk here on VCY America. My name is Jim Schneider. A little frog in throat, but trust you'll be able to bear with me here today. As we do present a news roundup today here on Crosstalk, we like to dedicate as much as possible our Friday programs to covering a lot of the topics and issues that arise during the week that perhaps go unnoticed or unreported or underreported in many, many cases, but to keep you informed on some of the vital issues that are impacting us across the nation. Tuesday of this week, my eyebrows were raised when I saw this headline come through: Arlington National Cemetery told to recognize gay partners as married. This is from the American Family Association that says that equating homosexual partners to legitimate marriage, a spokesman for Secretary of Defense Leon Panetta said policy for burial at Arlington National Cemetery is now under review. Among sweeping changes just signed by the departing Panetta are the issues of military ID cards, which will give same-sex spouses and partners access to on-base commissaries, movie theaters, and gyms. Other changes that Panetta is pushing for are prohibited by DOMA, the Defense of Marriage Act, which Panetta and the Obama administration have asked the Supreme Court to overturn. This means the military will recognize homosexual lovers as married and will give a full slate of benefits, including burial in Arlington National Cemetery. They have put out a full alert on this, but I'm looking at a letter that went out from the Secretary of Defense on February 11th. It's a memorandum for secretaries of the military departments acting under Secretary of Defense for personnel and readiness, the subject being extending benefits to same-sex domestic partners of military members. He talks about in this memo that implementation of these benefit changes will require substantial policy revision, training, and in the case of identification cards, technical upgrades that are going to be going on. He goes through a full, there is pages, additional benefits here. Additional benefits for same-sex domestic partners include dependent ID cards, which will be renewed in accordance with existing policies, commissary privileges, exchange privileges, morale, welfare, and recreational programs, surveys of military families, emergency leave of absence, youth sponsorship programs, youth programs, family care programs, sexual assault counseling programs, joint duty assignments, exemption from hostile fire areas, payments to missing persons, space available travel on the Department of Defense aircraft, child care, legal assistance, on and on the list goes. And talks about a person in a domestic partnership is one who is in such a partnership with a service member of the same sex. It means a committed relationship between two adults of the same sex that meets all of the requirements below. And they go through and list those, such as being at least 18 years of age, that you are each other's sole domestic partner, neither is married, and share common residence, and on the list goes. But Arlington National Cemetery told to recognize gay partners as married. AFA is recommending that you contact your congressman on this issue. Of course, the main switchboard number to Congress is 202-225-3121. Well, in the midst of trillions and trillions and trillions of dollars in deficit here that we've amassed as a nation, did you know we don't have a spending problem? No, it's not a spending problem, but we suffer from something else. It's called a misallocation of wealth. This is Senator Tom Harkins of Iowa yesterday, and he made that statement that the U.S. government does not have a spending problem, but America suffers from a misallocation of wealth. Listen to what he had to say.
I think, first of all, I want to disagree with those who say we have a spending problem. Everybody keeps saying we have a spending problem. And when they talk about that, it's like there's an assumption that somehow we as a nation are broke. We can't afford these things any longer. We're too broke to invest in education and housing and things like that. Well, look at it this way. We're the richest nation in the history of the world. We are now the richest nation in the world. We have the highest per capita income of any major nation. That kind of begs the question, doesn't it? If we're so rich, why are we so broke? Is it a spending problem? No. It's because we have a misallocation of capital, a misallocation of wealth. All of this wealth that's been built up by hardworking Americans has been accumulated in fewer and fewer and fewer hands all the time.
So what do we do? Have the government take it? Is that what he is asking? He says, is a spending problem? No, it's because we have a misallocation of capital, a misallocation of wealth. And then that statement where he said, all of this wealth that's been built up by hardworking Americans has been accumulated into fewer and fewer and fewer hands all the time. Wow. Are we talking socialism, Mr. Harkin? Here's another interesting clip from this week. Defense Secretary Leon Panetta. Of course, as he is outgoing and has done some pretty outrageous things in his final days, including, as we just mentioned, the further LGBT-related issues, the promotion, using this as a social experiment within our military, but also putting women on the front lines. And he said this week that Hillary Clinton inspired him, inspired his decision to allow women in combat.
Hillary Clinton is one of the most informed, most passionate, and most dedicated public servants that I've had the privilege to serve alongside. She has devoted her life to expanding opportunities for everyone to build a better future for this country and the world, because she believes everyone deserves a chance to fulfill their dreams and their aspirations. And in many ways, I have to tell you, it was her inspiration that encouraged me to move forward, to be able to bring down the last barriers for women in the Department of Defense and to give them the ability to have a chance to engage in combat. And I thank you for that inspiration.
Well, that was Leon Panetta here with that comment that Hillary Clinton was the inspiration for him to put women on the front lines. I guess one could come up with different conclusions than what was issued there. But it's also interesting to note that Chicago Mayor Rahm Emanuel, Hillary Clinton, of course, has been rumored to have aspirations for running for president in 2016. But Chicago Mayor Rahm Emanuel, according to the Daily Beast, is said by well-connected Democrats to be considering the idea of running for president if Hillary opts out of the 2016 race. Emanuel, who's busy raising funds right now for his 2015 reelection campaign for Chicago, has had discussions both over the phone and face-to-face in the past month with Democratic Party donors and fundraisers about a possible White House run, according to various sources. Well, a Supreme Court Justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg says that the Texas law that's at the heart of the Roe versus Wade Supreme Court decision back in 73, she said this ruling was the most extreme law in the country, referring to Texas that had outlawed abortions except in cases where the mother's life was in danger. She said, I should say, because I've been criticized for it. She's against Roe versus Wade. She says, no, I'm not. I'm very much for the judgment of the court rendered dealing with what was the most extreme law in the country, where a woman could get an abortion only if it was necessary to save her life. She said this during a discussion at the Harvard Law School. Shocking news that came forth this week by WorldNet Daily and several other sources here, too. One of the FBI's former top experts on Islam has announced that President Obama's pick to head the Central Intelligence Agency, John Brennan, converted to Islam years ago in Saudi Arabia. As WND had reported, former FBI Islam expert John Guandolo has long warned that the federal government is becoming infiltrated by members of the radical Muslim Brotherhood, but now warns that by appointing Brennan to CIA director, Obama has not only chosen a man naive to these infiltrations, but also picked a candidate who himself is a Muslim. He told, said in an interview this week, quote, Mr. Brennan did convert to Islam when he served in an official capacity on behalf of the United States in Saudi Arabia. The fact alone is not what is most disturbing. His conversion to Islam was the culmination of a counterintelligence operative against him to recruit him. The fact that foreign intelligence service operatives recruited Mr. Brennan when he was in a very sensitive and senior U.S. government position in a foreign country means that he's either a traitor or has the inability to discern and understand how to walk in those kinds of environments, which makes him completely unfit to be the director of Central Intelligence. Also, Harry Reid has floated a trial balloon this week by calling for an expedited vote this yesterday on a closure for the confirmation of Chuck Hagel as Secretary of Defense. The closure vote failed to get the 60 votes required. It came with 58-40 with one voting present. Three Republicans joined 55 Democrats in the vote. Reid is expected to make another attempt on this, when the Senate reconvenes on February 25th. Susan Collins, a moderate Republican who was previously expected to endorse her former colleague, made this announcement. She said, "In my judgment, Islamist terrorism, a nuclear-armed North Korea, and potentially a nuclear-armed Iran, our unstable and chaotic Middle East, cyber attacks, Chinese provocations, and budget constraints will likely consume the attention of our country's national security leaders during the next 4 years." She said, "I believe a vote in favor of Hagel would send the wrong signal to our military, the American people, and the world about America's resolve regarding the most important national security challenges of our era. I was unable to support Senator Hagel to be the next Secretary of Defense because I do not believe his past positions, votes, and statements match the challenges of our time, and his presentations at his hearing did nothing to ease my doubts." Wow. That was Susan Collins making that statement. And from the ACLJ, the American Center for Law and Justice, they say that Hagel is an anti-Israel former senator who had refused to sign a letter supporting Israel, opposed labeling Hezbollah a terrorist organization, and supported direct dialogue with the terrorist groups Hamas. Hagel even voted against labeling Iran's Revolutionary Guard Corps, which had a long history of terrorist activity, as being a terrorist organization. Well, they've got a petition drive going at the ACLJ. Others are urging people across the nation to contact their U.S. senators at 202-224-3121. Well, in light of all this, North Korea conducted its third nuclear test on Tuesday in defiance of existing U.N. resolutions, drawing condemnation from around the world, including China, its only major ally. The reclusive North said the test was an act of self-defense against U.S. hostility and threatened further stronger steps if necessary. Barack Obama labeled the test a highly provocative act that hurt regional stability and pressed for new sanctions. But also interesting that the president is calling for lessening our nuclear weaponry here across the United States. Well, let's see. Iceland. Government of Iceland is considering introducing internet filters such as those used to block China off the World Wide Web in order to stop their citizens downloading or viewing pornography on the internet. They have fears about damaging effects of the internet on children and women. Iceland's interior minister is drafting legislation to stop the access of online pornographic images and videos by young people through computers, game consoles, and by smartphones. Well, folks, you wouldn't believe what's happening in Missouri at the University of Missouri. No exams on Wiccan holidays. We'll have the story when we come back. You're listening to Crosstalk on VCY America.
Back to Genesis with Dr. John Morris, geologist and president at the Institute for Creation Research. Dr. Morris, are there any new dinosaur discoveries?
Chris, there's always something new. Evolutionists realize that it's a career boost if they can find a new and different dinosaur. In many people's minds, these beasts are almost equated with evolution. To find the new dinosaur fossil means to find evidence for evolution in many people's minds. But this is bad thinking. Dinosaurs fit very well into the creationist idea, too. These are even mentioned in the Bible as created on days 5 and 6 of Creation Week, and even lived after the flood. Chris, we can develop a whole biblical doctrine of dinosaurs. Of course, you have to go back to Genesis to do that.
Thanks, Dr. Morris. For more information on the foundational principles set forth in Genesis, simply visit us on the web at www.icr.org. That's www.icr.org. This is Chris O'Brien. God bless.
This is Crosstalk on VCY America, a news roundup Friday here today. Yeah, it's right. This came forth on Fox News today that students at University of Missouri don't need to cram for exams that fall on Wiccan and pagan holidays now that the school has put them on par with Christmas, Thanksgiving, and Hanukkah. The university's latest guide to religions, major holidays, and suggested accommodations. It's designed to help faculty know when and when not to schedule exams and other student activities. It lists 8 Wiccan and pagan holidays and events right alongside more mainstream occasions, all part of the school's effort to include everyone's beliefs. The first holiday on the list is the Hindu 2-day festival celebrating the birth of Krishna, a god considered to be a warrior, hero, teacher, and philosopher. Other holidays like Ramadan, Rosh Hashanah, Easter are included in the guide. 43 holidays with varying degrees of suggested accommodations to be granted to students. For Sanheim, listed as a pagan and Wiccan celebration, considered by some to be the Wiccan New Year, general practices include paying respect to ancestors, family members, elders of the faith, friends, pets, and other loved ones who have died. The holiday coincides with Halloween. The Chinese New Year, meanwhile, is billed as the most important of traditional Chinese holidays, with Confucian, Taoist, and Buddhist religions, and corresponds to the new moon in Aquarius, which can now occur between late January through mid-February. This year's celebration fell on Sunday. And here's what the guide says. Avoid scheduling important academic deadlines, events, and activities on this date. Many Chinese employees will probably request the day off. University officials said no complaints have been received in connection to the guide, but now including a number of Wiccan pagan holidays for the University of Missouri. Well, yesterday, Valentine's Day, the Illinois Senate approved legislation that, if passed by the House, would create same-sex marriage in the state of Illinois. We understand that the state House of Representatives is expected to discuss the bill in the next 2 weeks. In just a moment, I'm going to be providing you some phone numbers to the State of Illinois House for you to share your views on this issue. So be ready to jot those down if you want to have your voice heard. I know we have a number of Illinois listeners. The Illinois Senate voted 34 to 21, largely along party lines, with most Democrats voting in favor of same-sex marriage, most Republicans voting in opposition to it. And Pat Quinn, who is the governor of Illinois, promising to sign this bill, which would legalize homosexual marriage, saying that full equality for all people is a right for Illinois. The House is also controlled by Democrats, but the fate of the legislation in the lower chamber remains a question mark. It's unclear when representatives might take up that proposal, and they cite that part of the hang-up is that there are a number of African Americans who are contacting their legislators saying, no, this is a violation of their beliefs that marriage is not to be between one man and one woman. Their beliefs states that it is between a man and a woman. As this went before the Senate yesterday, there was an amendment that had been passed that would had been drafted by the committee. They are calling this same-sex marriage bill the Religious Freedom and Marriage Fairness Act. The Religious Freedom and Marriage Fairness Act, providing that all laws of the state applicable to marriage apply equally to marriages of same-sex and different-sex couples and their children. Parties to a marriage and their children, regardless of whether the marriage is of a same-sex or different-sex couple, have the same benefits, protections, and responsibilities under law. Parties to a marriage are included in any definition or use of terms such as spouse, family, immediate family, dependent, next of kin, wife, husband, bride, groom, wedlock, and other terms that refer or denote the spousal relationship, as those terms are used throughout the law, regardless of whether the parties to a marriage are of the same sex or different sex. They are going to be convening, according to news accounts, within the next couple of weeks. Regarding this, it's Senate Bill number 10 in Illinois. But I'd like to give to you quickly the phone numbers of those who make up the, this is in the Rules Committee right now at the Illinois General Assembly. There are 5 people in the Rules Committee. And in addition to their 5 names and numbers, there are 2 additional numbers I'm going to give to you, 7 numbers in all. Everyone has the same area code, 217. Area code 217. And everyone has the same prefix of 782. So if you write down 217, then 782, I'll give you the last four digits, and as we go through this list, for you to contact and let your voice be heard, especially those of you in the state of Illinois. Many of you listening do business in the state or with the state of Illinois. The chair of the committee, who is also the majority leader, is Barbara Flynn Curry. I'll just say she is the chairperson, the majority leader of the state assembly. Her last four digits are 8121. So already you have down area code 217, and then the prefix is 782. So her four digits are 8121. 8121. The Republican spokesperson that sits on this committee, Timothy Schmitz, is 5457. 5457. Other committee members include Lou Lang, 1252. 1252. David Litch, 8108, 8108, and Frank Martino, 0140, 0140. These are the five people who make up the committee who right now hold this bill. The bill passed the Senate. It got messaged over to the State House, the State General Assembly, and these five people are on the Rules Committee, which received the bill from the Senate. It's my understanding that they will make determination about putting this on the Assembly House calendar. In addition to these five people, you can contact the House Speaker's Office, 5350, same area code, same prefix, but the number is 5350, and the Minority Leader of the House, 1331, 1331. We have had some stories here on Crosstalk regarding the huge amount of bullets and ammunition that's being bought by the federal government, Department of Homeland Security. Well, on FoxNews.com yesterday, they reported that the Homeland Security Department wants to buy more than 1.6 billion, billion rounds of ammunition in the next 4 or 5 years. It says it needs them that's roughly the equivalent of 5 bullets for every person in the United States. But they say they need them for law enforcement agents in training and on duty. Their explanation is this, that federal solicitations to buy the bullets are known as strategic sourcing contracts, which help the government get a low price for a big purchase, says Peggy Dixon, spokesperson for the Federal Law Enforcement Training Center in Georgia. The training center and others like it run by the Homeland Security Department use as many as 15 million rounds every year. Okay, 15 million rounds a year, and they're buying 1.6 billion rounds in the next 4 to 5 years. They use about 15 million rounds every year, mostly on shooting ranges and in training exercises, she said. Dixon said one of the contracts would allow Homeland Security to buy up to 750 million rounds of ammunition over the next 5 years for its training facilities. The rest of the 1.6 billion rounds of ammunition would be purchased by Immigration and Customs Enforcement, that's ICE. They oversee the large criminal investigation agency on, supposedly to secure our borders. The Homeland Security ammo buy is not the first time the government's bullets purchased have sparked concerns on the internet. The same thing happened last year when the Social Security Administration posted a notice that it was buying 174,000 hollow point bullets. Jonathan Lasher, the agency's Assistant Inspector General for External Relations, said those bullets were for the Social Security Inspector General's office, which has about 295 agents. Who investigate Social Security fraud and other crimes. OneNewsNow.com reports France's lower house of parliament Tuesday of this week approved a sweeping bill to legalize gay marriage and allow same-sex couples to adopt children, handing a major legislative victory to their president, François Hollande, socialist on a divisive social issue. That bill now goes to the Senate, which is controlled by the socialist and their allies. Well, let's go to the United Kingdom. Police officers will attend a course teaching them to ask transgendered people whether they would like to be known as a man or a woman. Officers will be taught to apologize straight away if they do not refer to the transgendered person's preferred sex. The course has been introduced by Sussex Police and will also include a transgender member of the force speaking to the staff. Okay, boy, there are so many news stories here. Let me share a few here that deal with the life issue. Hundreds, this is an interesting story about also from Britain. Hundreds, possibly thousands of patients have died from lack of care in British hospitals in what an official government investigation termed the biggest scandal in NHS history. That's the National Health Service. Between 2005 and 2009, up to 1,200 patients died unnecessarily, and many more were failed by a system which ignores the warning signs and puts corporate self-interest and cost control, underline those words, cost control, i.e. death panels, putting self-interest and cost control ahead of patients and their safety, according to the London Telegraph. Patients and their families have been warning for years that care was inadequate. Professor Sir Brian Jarman, an international authority on hospital performance, said he warned the government in early 2010 about the high death rates at four of the hospitals now under investigation, kind of reallocating medical resources there. Meanwhile, in Canada, LifeNews.com reports a Canadian Medical Association found that 16% of the doctors who completed a survey, 2,125 doctors, who completed the survey would be willing to euthanize a patient if legal. 44% they would refuse requests for euthanasia. 26% of the doctors were unsure how they would respond to requests for euthanasia. And 15% of the physicians did not respond. Japan's having a crisis. Her finance minister has only been on the job for a month. It's already stirring up enough controversy to last a lifetime. LifeNews.com reports that in January he made headlines around the world when he told a panel on Social Security reforms that the elderly should be permitted to hurry up and die. It hits too close to home because much of Japan's ever more dire fiscal problems can be traced to the country's demographics, but the problem lies at the beginning of life, not the end. They're cutting off through abortion and their so-called education, trying to stop births from taking place in Japan. Well, they find now that their demographics are changing. The cost of caring for its elderly is a large part of why Japan's debt-to-GDP ratio is an astounding 229%, nearly 2.5 times that of the United States. But, folks, the U.S. is headed that direction. And now they have their finance minister saying people should be permitted to hurry up and die. Well, you say that's Japan. Let's go to the state of Texas. A measure in the Texas legislature under fire from a national pro-life group that say it would allow doctors the right to refuse giving CPR to patients. The National Right to Life Committee is calling for defeat of a Texas bill, SB 303, in Texas, that would allow doctors to impose do not resuscitate orders on patients, even if doing so would violate the patient's express wishes. Folks, you're going to see, just as abortion has come about, we're going to see an all-out push for, quote-unquote, death with dignity. A push for euthanasia taking place. Not only do you have a right to die, but you have a duty to die. I've got a few more stories to share after the break. You're listening to Crosstalk on VCY America.
Nearly 90% of Christian children attend a public school. Filmmaker Colin Gunn, a homeschool father of seven, went on the field trip of a lifetime. Driving an old school bus, Colin and his family traveled across the nation, exploring the origins and social impact of public school education to discover if children are morally and physically safe, if public schools are religiously neutral, and should Christians try to be salt and light in secular schools. 102 minutes in length, it's an impactful message. In the companion book, Indoctrination, some 18 writers come together to look at how the educational system is actively at work to alter your child's moral values, worldview, and religious beliefs. It explores the biblical principles regarding education and who is ultimately responsible for our children's future. The Indoctrination DVD is available for a donation of $22. The book is available for a donation of $18, or you can obtain both for a donation of $35. To obtain yours, call 1-800-729-9829, 1-800-729-9829.
Seems like I've got a ream of paper in the studio today. Just so much going on this week. But you all heard about this approaching asteroid that was passing by the Earth in the last hour. Well, an interesting story came out last weekend. CNN anchor Deb Farrick asked Saturday afternoon if this approaching asteroid, which was passing by the Earth today, she asked, quote, is this an example of perhaps global warming? Oh, my. Okay, here we go. CNSnews.com. The White House is not saying where President Barack Obama was, what he did, or whom he spoke to between 5:30 p.m. September 11th, 2012, when he finished a meeting with Defense Secretary Leon Panetta and General Martin Dempsey, which took place while the Benghazi terrorist attacks were unfolding. Between that time of 5:30 and 11:26 p.m. that night, which is approximately the time that the former Navy SEALs Tyrone Woods and Glenn Dougherty were killed by the attacks. White House isn't saying, not releasing that information when asked for it. I found it also very interesting on this story from CNSnews.com that Secretary of State John Kerry took a larger detail of security agents on a trip to Arlington, Virginia last week, where he went to visit, of all places, the headquarters of the Department Security Bureau. He had more security agents than the State Department employed to its compound in Benghazi, Libya, in the days leading up to the September 11, 2012 terrorist attacks. Kerry, as recorded by an official State Department publicity photograph, was surrounded in Arlington on Monday, February 4th, by at least four of the department's diplomatic security agents. In the days leading up to the Benghazi attacks, the State Department deployed only three diplomatic security agents to the department's mission in Benghazi. More agents needed to travel to Arlington, Virginia, than to Libya, Benghazi? Judicial Watch released previous unseen USDA videos. You know, United States Department of Agriculture? The story came out yesterday from Judicial Watch. USDA videos revealing compulsory cultural sensitivity training program requiring USDA employees to chant in unison, "The pilgrims were illegal aliens. The pilgrims were illegal aliens," while being instructed to no longer use the term minorities, but they are to replace minorities with a new term called emerging majorities. The sensitivity training sessions, described as a huge expense by the diversity awareness trainer and self-described citizen of the world, Samuel Batances, were held on the USDA premises. The diversity event is apparently part of what USDA Secretary Tom Vilsack described in a memo sent to all agency employees as, quote, a new era of civil rights and a broader effort toward cultural transformation at USDA. In 2011 and 2012, the USDA paid Bettences and his firm nearly $200,000 for their part in the cultural transformation program. This USDA diversity training video depicts out-of-control political correctness, said Tom Fitton, president of Judicial Watch. Can anyone please explain how any of this helps USDA employees to better serve the American taxpayer? This video further explains that politically correct diversity training programs are both offensive and a waste of taxpayer money. No wonder it took over a half a year to obtain the video through the Freedom of Information Act request for, through the Obama administration. My. And then we wonder about this spending issue. We don't. What were the words that he said? We had it at the beginning of the program today. No, we don't have a spending problem. We suffer from a misallocation of wealth. Talking about misallocation. Oh, and this story as well came out from CNSnews.com that since taking office in 2009, food stamp rolls under President Barack Obama have risen to more than 47 million people in America, which exceeds the population of the nation of Spain. Wow. Here's a bit of bright news for the week. After a nurse sued for being forced to participate in an abortion in 2009, at a New York hospital, that hospital has now changed its policies and procedures so that pro-life medical personnel no longer have to violate their religious beliefs when it comes to abortion. And Senator Frank Lautenberg, a pro-abortion legislator from New Jersey, announces this week he will be retiring from his Senate seat and will not be seeking re-election in 2014. If you'd like to comment on some of these stories today, let's get to the phone lines. I've got more stories to share, but let's hear from you. If you'd like to comment on the stories today, our number 800-733-9829. If you'd like to comment on these stories or some other event of current news, we'd sure welcome your input today. What do you think about Tom Harkins saying that the U.S. doesn't have a spending problem, but America suffers from a misallocation of wealth? Rather amazing, isn't it? 800-733-9829 is our telephone number. Also, LifeNews.com reports that, while getting on board, I'll just share a couple other things. Parents of a Texas teenager have been temporarily stopped from pressuring their daughter to have an abortion. The teen girl is suing her parents to stop them from making her have an abortion. Attorneys with the Center for Defense of Life have filed suit on behalf of the 16-year-old expectant mom who says her parents are trying to force her to have an abortion of a baby she wants to keep. The teenager, who's 2 months pregnant and asking a judge to stop her parents from making her with an abortion by coercing her with verbal and physical threats and by harassment. Where is Planned Parenthood? Planned Parenthood always says a woman has a right to choose. Well, here's a woman who's choosing to keep her baby. Where is Planned Parenthood? Why are they not coming to her defense? Why is NARAL Pro-Choice America not standing up for this young gal, giving her the right to carry that baby? I haven't seen press releases coming forth from them. I haven't seen the ACLU putting forth press reports trying to stop this from taking place. What about that right to choose? Don't be fooled, folks. They don't believe in right to choose. They believe in abortion. And I believe, it's my opinion, abortion at all costs. Well, let's get your comments and thoughts here today. 800-733-9829. Let's begin in West Milwaukee with John. John, go ahead. You're on the air.
Yes. Afternoon. I'd like to reflect a little something that's affecting me, plus a whole bunch of other people at the VA. And that is Monday, we had our little IT meeting, and we're informed that we're all going to get a 20% pay cut. Now, IT is a little job here that I make $2.15 an hour, but with that 20% pay cut, that means I'll be making $1.73 an hour. But the word's out that it's going to be affecting nurses and everybody. And like I say, I think the people that decide this stuff, I think they just voted on a pay raise.
Okay. Thank you, John, for sharing your thoughts on that issue. I don't have information on it, but thanks for bringing it to our attention. Mobile, Alabama, Joan, you're on the air.
Thank you. Yesterday on nationwide TV, the president said he is the most transparent president we've ever had in the White House. But I get Phyllis Schlafly's report every single month, and since the late 80s, and she said that he has Muslim Brotherhood friends, and he said the Muslim Brotherhood is good. He said that last year, and they said that he said everyone yesterday, everyone that comes in the White House has to sign in. Well, guess what? Phyllis Schlafly said that his Muslim Brotherhood friends eat supper with them at the White House, and they have told the people there that they are not to sign in.
Well,
and that's just, you know, and his saying he got 6 million new jobs while he's been in office. Well, the real truth is 1.2 million. You know, it's just most things that he says, if you really look into things, it's just amazing.
Well,
the country is going down the tube.
Joan, thanks for your comments here today. On this most transparent presidency, your initial comment there, is this why group after group has to fight and file lawsuits to have documents released using Freedom of Information Act requests? Is this why those things are stifled? Is this why the Department of Justice refuses to release the documents pertaining to Fast and Furious? Is this why there's refusal to give school records from colleges and transcripts and all the other things that have been requested by so many? Is this really a transparent presidency? Let's go to James calling from Toma. You're on the air, James.
Yeah, thank you for taking my call. I don't know how many things I can bring up here. First, I wanted to comment on the hypocrisy of the pro-choice movement in trying to violate this little girl's choice by forcing an abortion on her. You know, I think this really highlights where their attentions really are. Secondly, when you're talking about the socialist comments by a senator, what about the president who now wants our minimum wage to be $9 an hour?
It's going to put a lot of people out of work, isn't it, and cause
this
harm
asteroid,
to small businesses.
This asteroid passing by the Earth at 17,000 miles, were you aware that a meteor also hit Russia just about an hour before that?
Yeah, yeah.
They're looking at 1,100 people injured. So a lot of things going on all at once.
Thank you, James, for your comments here today. Our number to Crosstalk, 800-733-9829. To Joplin, Missouri. Josh, you're on the air.
Hi, I wanted to comment about Harkin's comment on misallocation of wealth.
Yeah.
I think he was right on the money, because the wealth is not the wealth of the 1%. It's the wealth of the elite class that is our government, and we are no longer a republic. We are now owned by the elite class, who is now owned by the International Monetary Fund. This is a global conspiracy. And these guys own everything. They can do what they want. They can say what they want. And the voting system is a fraud. The Constitution is no longer followed. And that is very apparent with the decisions these guys are making. And my suggestion is that we get on our face before our God, and we repent of our sin, and we bring him back into the hearts of his people.
Yeah, amen. Thank you, Josh. Appreciate your sharing that. To Green Bay, Wisconsin, John, you're on the air.
Yes, sir. I just wanted to pass along this warning, as I see it, about a coming recession. The Great Recession of 08, meaning two quarters of negative growth, wasn't announced as such when it happened. They were revised numbers after Obama was inaugurated, and they blamed Bush. The fourth quarter of last year, we had negative GDP growth by 0.1%. March 1st of this year, President Obama's self-imposed sequestration is going to throw this economy into another tailspin, and we will have a full-blown six-month recession on our hands. And the only way that this president knows how to deal with it is spend us further into debt, totally wreck the economy, and I am predicting we are going to have some very, very, remember 09, people, what a desperate time it was. We're going to wish for the gravy salad days of 09 this next coming year. Thank you.
Thank you, John, for your comments. Quickly to Luke on the road. Go ahead, Luke.
Hi. I'm a math major, and I've done quite a few calculations on the minimum wage and, you know, the deficit and things like that, just because I get bored and I think it's fun to do those types of things. Anyway, but about the minimum wage, I don't understand why everyone is so up in arms about raising some wage. I understand that, yes, it's going to cost businesses a little more money, but in terms of keeping in line with inflation, minimum wage has stayed rather flat while inflation has gone up by roughly 3% every year since the beginning of currency.
Okay, thank you, Luke. Got your point here. We've got a break upon us, so I've got to take a break there. Many have seen it, though, as being a great hurt to small businesses, and businesses are actually going to lose jobs rather than create them. We'll be back in 1 minute.
For the Worldview Week in Minute, I'm Brennan House. Our website is worldviewweekend.com. Recently, the Washington Times reported that leading evangelicals, like the president of the National Association of Evangelicals and some folks with the Southern Baptist Convention and others, including Jim Wallace's organization, Sojourners, are working together to bring about citizenship for millions of illegal aliens. Well, regardless of what you think about this, and I'm not for it, because there are many social issues that have been brought on by illegal immigration, including the lack of jobs for current American citizens. But regardless of how you feel about it, this group was reported in the Washington Times as saying that now there needs to be a campaign on this issue, and the church needs to get right on this issue by reading Matthew 25, the exhortation to clothe and feed the stranger. My friends, if we read that in context, Jesus refers to those people as brethren, Christians, fellow disciples. Let's not take Scripture out of context to push a public policy agenda.
listening to Crosstalk here on VCY America, and yeah, that break came quickly on us here at the quarter of the hour mark. But yeah, there are those who are also on this minimum wage issue saying, you know, this is one of the reasons what has caused U.S. jobs to go overseas because of the cheaper labor costs that are available in other places in regard to that. And further, that's going to increase the prices of product as well. When wages rise, it can affect productivity. More workers enter the job market, allowing businesses to choose more high-skilled workers in that regard as well. But there's a number of issues that have come forth as far as concerns regarding it, and especially in the entry-level jobs taking place. There's great consideration on that issue. But I know that's a matter up for debate, and maybe some of you others want to comment on it. Let's go to Washington State. And, Ron, thanks for calling. You're on the air.
Yes, sir. Just about some of this, quote, gay marriage, unquote. There's nothing gay about sodomy. It's just an offshoot of the fact that the Supreme Court has taken the place of God, deciding right and wrong, and abolishing all laws against sodomy. Well, if sodomy's not wrong, then imposing it is wrong. So there goes your freedom of religion, your freedom of speech. You can't talk about it. You can't even tell all the harmful effects of it. There goes your freedom of the press. You can't write about it. There goes your freedom of assembly. You can't choose whom to include and who to exclude. You'll have sexual perverts in Boy Scouts and in the military like you do now, and they always hush up all the problems that it caused. And, of course, you can't complain about it. There goes your right to complain, to petition for a redress of grievances. So the entire First Amendment is just absolutely gutted when they do stuff like that.
Yeah, I think
the problem is that we should just recriminalize sodomy. We need preachers who are willing to stand on the word of God and what right and wrong is. We have four types of preachers, the ones that who will stand on the word of God. You have the heretics who are pushing this. You have the callous who don't care, and the cowardly who are afraid that giving units might walk out of their church. With people like that, we will never regain any semblance of righteousness in this country, and that's exactly what we need. We need righteousness. We don't need this wickedness.
Righteousness exalts a nation, but sin is a reproach to any people, Scripture
says. Amen.
Thank you, Ron. Appreciate your call.
God bless.
Bye-bye now. Jessica in Milwaukee, you're on the air. Hello, Jessica.
Hello. Yes. I love your program. I listen a lot, and I do call when you give the numbers out, and I have the White House on speed dial and so on. But my question is, and others have raised this, what other things can we do? I mean, it doesn't seem to, it's just still getting worse. I wish you would do a program sometime, you know, on what we can do to turn it around. I mean, we fear the government. It's supposed to be the other way around. I wish I had more, you know, ideas on how to turn that around so they feared me again, which is how I think it should be.
Well, let me just say this, Jessica, and we have addressed that many times as we have this whole issue. I mean, even today when we talk about Illinois, we gave some phone numbers to contact for legislators there. But here's what Scripture says. It says, moreover, it's required of stewards that a man be found faithful. So what can you do, Jessica? Stay faithful to the principles of God's word. And the previous caller had made reference to the fact that if my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven, will forgive their sin. I'm going to heal their land. And it really behooves the church to become the church, to become that which is going to hold a standard of truth and righteousness that's exhibited from their own lives. And sadly, we've really missed the boat on that regard in many a church. And just even as a previous caller talked about, we need to have a sound biblical preaching taking place from our pulpits. Sadly, what we're seeing is an increasing number of pulpits that instead want to tickle the ears rather than to preach God's truth.
I do appreciate that, and I do pray go to a very wonderful Baptist church that I found. And so I do agree with you on that.
And, you know, Jessica, what else can you do? You know, I think about here in the state of Wisconsin, we have a primary that's coming up this coming Tuesday, February 19th. Do you know the voter turnout is expected to be less than 10%? And we talk about, oh, how important these things are to us. And there's a Supreme Court justice that's on the ballot. But when you get less than 10% who have the interest to even go to the polls and vote, woe be to us.
I am a voter. I know. Well, I guess, you know, I guess you're somewhat answering my question that there's only certain things you can do, I guess.
And people
just need to do them more.
And be faithful in doing them. So, yeah, to recap, yeah, we have that responsibility here toward our government, voting, letting our voices heard to legislative officials. But we have that responsibility to God as well, to be found faithful, to be salt, to be light, to stay true to the principles of His Word, and to pray. Pray for those who are in authority. The Bible tells us to do that as well. Appreciate your call. Quakerstown, Pennsylvania, and Beatrice, you're on the air.
Hi. Oh, my gosh. The last two callers almost asked the same thing that I want to ask.
Mm-hmm.
I keep hearing about all these groups who can go to Washington and get same-sex everything. Where are the Christian groups that can go to Washington and get all of the same-sex undone? Where do we go? How do we go about legally stopping all this same-sex stuff that's going on in our country? I can't take it anymore. Every time they take God out of something, they let the devil into it. He's already in too many places in our country, and I've had just about enough. I do not know what to do or where to go. Most churches are so different. There's not a whole lot of Christians in church. That's all I've found out. There's not a whole lot of Christians in the churches, and so it's not. I can't go to the churches to try and get a group together to say, okay, you know, we've had enough. I do believe there's more Christians in this country than there are people who seem to think that two people of the same sex should be able to be married, and we have to pay for them the way we pay for a heterosexual marriage. I am just so sick and tired of it, but I just cannot find anywhere. I look online, I listen to programs like yours. Where do we go? What do we do? And how do we get these people that are in Washington who's saying, yes, everything for everybody? How do we get them out?
Thank you, Beatrice. And our theme is playing here, which means I'm out of time here on the broadcast today. But let me just say that as I just exercised moments ago in my response to another caller, when we have an election coming up that's putting on the bench Supreme Court justice, and you have less than 10% of the people turning out, we've got to stay engaged. We've got to stay engaged both to our nation and stay engaged to the Christian life as well. Our time is gone, folks. Thanks for joining us on Crosstalk. I trust you'll be in a Bible-believing local church this Sunday.
You've been listening to Crosstalk via satellite and the Internet from VCY America. Views expressed may or may not be those of this station. For a CD of today's program, send a donation of $6 or more to VCY Tape Ministry, 3434 West Kilbourne Avenue, Milwaukee, Wisconsin, 53208. Or download by RSS or podcast from crosstalkamerica.com. And join us again for Crosstalk.